Hello and welcome to another Basic Fantasy Actual Play series. This one is entitled The Tower of Nicodemicus. And this video is a prologue to that. Those of you who have watched the Actual Play series from last year, many of you who watched the Actual Play series from last year, the Royal Catacomb of Adri, ask for more actual play, ask for more of these characters, these players that I have gathered together from various places on the planet. And while I'm in general agreeable, those of you who've been with me for a while will remember that the editing of those videos was slow for a lot of reasons that I'm not going to go into, other than to say that they were probably personal. And it held up the entire channel. My intention was, with Royal Catacomb of Adri, I recorded a Solemnrise Speaks video, Let's Build a Dungeon, where I actually took Dyson Logos' excellent map, the Royal Catacomb of Adri, and made an adventure around it for Basic Fantasy. And then I ran it and recorded four sessions of actual play with my regular players, my regular online players, and I ran those videos first before releasing the Solemnrise Speaks video. Well, that was my intention, was to just have them all come out, but the editing of the actual play videos took longer than I anticipated. It was my fault. It was me. I just ran into issues getting it done, and I found other priorities in my life, and I didn't pay attention to the channel. But the reaction to those videos was really positive. It's probably the only thing that motivated me to finish them. I've promised myself I'm not going to edit them as closely this time, this particular scenario that I'm running, but we'll see how this goes. I am making this prologue video partly to light a fire under me. I'm going to release it right away, and hopefully it will drive me to get at least the first session done in the next couple of weeks. I will probably, if I can't get the first session out by next week, I'll probably do another Solemnrise Speaks video. I don't normally talk about channel operations, but you know, that's where I'm at right now. I just want everybody to know what's going on. But some time has passed between Royal Catacomb of Adri and the adventure that you're going to see in the actual play series, and I kind of need to give you guys a little update on what's going on. The adventuring party from Royal Catacomb of Adri, in the order they come to my mind at this point, Armstrong, played by Will Sanders, Vernon, played by Brian Scalise, Nicodemicus, played by John Lopez. I should say it's actually Nicodemicus Wayburn. He actually does have a full name, Nicodemicus Wayburn, played by John Lopez, and then, as I say, Aldar, son of Keldwyril, played by Sergio Nemirovsky, and Jan Fellhammer, played by Thorin Schmidt. This is the group that left the town of Penrith, which is the kind of town where people go when they want to hide. And this is where they found Nicodemicus, actually, and where Aldar was also found. Aldar wasn't hiding, but his father was. So there you go. From Penrith, they followed the old Borderland Road, to which follows conventionally, traditionally, Anderonians talk about the border as if it runs due east and west, as if the border is a nice straight line going horizontal across the map. But in fact, it runs at a roughly 45 degree angle across the map, as much north as west, as much south as east. But nonetheless, they talk about it east and west as if it was following a line from east to west. So anyway, they followed the border to the west, or in other words, the northwest. Followed the old Borderland Road. They passed, actually visited and adventured at an old monastery. They encountered the infamous Troll Bridge, and dealt with the trolls rather more handily than I expected. At the junction, they took a left, staying in Anarone, heading back towards Kendall Keep, the most famous of the three keeps that reside on the northern border of Anarone. This is where things started to get interesting. Nicodemus discovered himself being recognized repeatedly. Now, those of you who followed the previous video series are familiar with the fact that Nicodemus is an old man, but only a low-level magic user. He claims to be an archmage, or to have been an archmage, and he always seems a little addled. He finally revealed to the rest of the party, after being recognized a couple of times, and not just recognized, but basically celebrated, he was invited to stay in the main keep at Kendall Keep rather than having to rent a room at the inn, and treated like an honored guest. The Castellan, Morgan von Darien, she told him it was too bad that he had arrived after Valor True, the famed paladin, had left, because he had been a comrade of her father, and surely he would like to see her. And Nicodemus had vague memories of bouncing a little girl on his knee and tried to imagine her as a full-grown paladin. Paladin is not a basic fantasy class. There is a supplement for it. I basically don't use it. I've never had a player want to play it. Valor True is a paladin in the social or conventional sense. She's a hero. She's a hero who has the full backing of the church. So, anyway, as I say, he continued being recognized as he went from place to place. Their intention is to return to the dungeons of Unlanden. They were teleported, well, part of the party was teleported away from Unlanden some time ago, well before the Royal Catacomb story adventure. But their intention is to return to the Unlanden area where Vernon's family can be found. He wants to go home, basically, and he has been making that rather clear to the point of being a little unhinged. And the party's intention has been to do that. So they follow the road from Kendall Keep through a variety of towns to the coastal city of Zanik, which was their plan was then to take a boat on Lake Dyassa, to book passage on Lake Dyassa to Lirwyn, the nearest port town to Inlandon, and save themselves a long walk. At the last town before reaching Zanik, they were approached by a messenger who had a message for Nicodemus. The message was from Count X, that is E-K-S X, of Zanik, the count of the entire area, inviting his old friend Nicodemus to come and stay with him at his castle of Zanik. So upon arriving at Zanik, they went more or less directly to, literally, I'll digress briefly, Zan is an old Argosian word for fort. If you look at a map of Glain, you'll see that there are a lot of towns with Zan in their names, all along the border between Roslyn and Anarone on both sides of the border. Even to the point that there's actually a place called Zanzan. It is literally the fortress of fortresses on the Roslanian side. Zanik is what the name Zan X, Fortress of X, became after generations. People stopped bothering to say it as if it was two words, and it became Zanik. So anyway, Zanik is the town, and Zanik is the fort. They went to Zanik, the fort, and they met with the Count, who didn't seem terribly surprised at the addled condition of his old friend Nicodemus. And he gave him a scroll tube, which he said Nicodemus had left with him in case of an emergency. The scroll tube had a marking on the end, on the cap, that Nicodemus recognized as being his sigil sigils are an outdated, old-fashioned way magic users identify themselves or their items in the world of Glane. It mostly isn't done anymore. Most magic users never bother to create a sigil or to use it on their own items because it is considered old-fashioned and somewhat silly. But there are a few places, a few very traditional families of wizards, including the D'Angelo family, who take sigils still rather seriously and use them a lot. Upon seeing this on the cap, Nicodemicus had a memory of the day he created the sigil in the company of a man and a woman whose identity he could not remember. And he scrawled something on a piece of paper. And then they called a scribe in who carefully transcribed what he had scrawled on a piece of paper into the book of sigils used in the house of D'Angelo to identify people. And while he doesn't remember the people, obviously there was a purpose to it. Obviously he needed a sigil to interact with these people properly. This will all be gotten into later, I'm certain. But at the moment, that was all he remembered. But he did recognize it as his. Removing the cap and pulling out the scroll within, he discovers a map showing the local area around Zanik in a great deal of detail, every small bridge and every little bit of terrain drawn carefully on the map, but with a fork in the road that they had not seen, leading to a carefully drawn but unlabeled tower. That'll all be in the beginning of the first video. We'll talk about that a little bit there, but just for your understanding. And so they made the decision that this must be his tower, the mage tower that Nicodemicus has bragged about since the beginning. This must be it. But Nicodemicus doesn't remember it, remembers very little about it. And so that is the nature of the adventure that I'm about to show. Now, Royal Catacomb of Adria is a generic adventure in the sense that any party could play it. It doesn't mean anything specific to anybody. I will probably release Tower of Nicodemicus, but it has a different meaning for my group than it would for any random group that just found a map, which is probably the hook that I'll use. I'll probably punch up the danger level somewhat. In the adventure, if I release it, this has been more of a voyage of discovery for the players, which is not to say there aren't going to be some fights. As I am recording this, we are preparing for the third and probably final session. The first two sessions have already been recorded, and I have begun the process of editing them. I've made about not quite an hour's progress out of the 2.5 hours worth of the first session, so I've got a ways to go to get it done. I'm planning on trying to get it done. I really would like to release it next week, but if it doesn't make it next week, it'll make it when it makes it. I have requested character portrait artwork from John Fredericks, one of our regular basic fantasy artists, the one who's done a number of character portraits for the game publications, including the cover art for the Equipment Emporium. Because there is a long sequence at the beginning of the first session where the screen is basically black because the players are just talking to each other, to NPCs, and so forth, planning what they're going to do, and I'm going to use the headshots. I have created a couple of other artistic representations that I'm going to drop in as we go along that were not necessarily on the screen as the players were playing. At one point, we use Discord for audio, and at one point I shared a picture on Discord. I will share it with you in the video. So, this is the prologue. This is the beginning. Nicodemicus apparently was an archmage. Apparently was quite powerful. Powerful enough to play with the basic forces of nature. But he doesn't remember any of that. For whatever reason, he has lost most of what he had. And now we find out what happens next. So, welcome. I hope you enjoy traveling along with my players and I on this adventure. After the three parts of this adventure, we as a group are going to evaluate whether we want to continue trying to record sessions. I have to get faster at editing them, which probably means I'm going to have to be less of a perfectionist. It just doesn't suit me to release an unfinished looking work. Those of you who follow the Basic Fantasy Project are familiar with the fact that we don't release something until it's ready. Which is great, I suppose, for printed works, but it probably isn't appropriate for video, so I may have to adjust my standards somewhat. I am not editing this as tightly as I did the first one, but I just can't resist removing awkward pauses, removing breaks when we take breaks. When five people try to talk at once, and I have the opportunity to do so, I generally try to clean up the audio. I am using the full six channels of audio from a recording through Craig. I recommend Craig. Craig works really well. It's a bot for Discord for recording voice channels. It works fantastic because it gives me six separate channels, one for each of my players and one for myself, that I can then work my way through. If I get an echo off of somebody else's channel, I can quiet it. If two or three people talk at the same time, but a couple of them are just saying, hey, 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 or something like that, I can clip the hey, hey, hey out and sort in the actual words that they're actually saying at an appropriate point in the conversation. But arrange matters so we're not talking over each other. It is really hard on an online game where you can't see anybody and you have different ping times for the different users. It's really hard not to talk over somebody. So I try to clean that up. And like I said, I've got to be maybe a little bit less of a perfectionist if I want to get this job done. So I hope you enjoy coming along with us on this journey, on this adventure, on this voyage of discovery for Nicodemicus Wayburn, and plenty of opportunities for role play by the other players. I will see you next time.